Connie Martinson Talks Books. No one can see that flower, that opening of the inside of a flower, and not say, oh, that must be Georgia O'Keeffe's work. Well, there's more to Georgia O'Keeffe than just the petals and the flowers. My guest today, Karen Carbo, has written How Georgia Became O'Keeffe, Lessons on the Art of Living, and it's published by Skirt, a division of Globe Picot. Welcome, Karen.
Hi, Connie, how are you?
I am fine, and what a time you had almost traveling in her footsteps.
It was a wonderful time. My husband and I did a six-week RV trip through the Southwest to Santa Fe and up into Abiquiu and Ghost Ranch, which is Georgia O'Keeffe territory.
But she was born where?
She was actually born in Sun Prairie, Wisconsin, and grew up on a dairy farm. So she's not a Southwesterner, but those big open skies and expanses were certainly imprinted upon her at an early age, and I think that's where she got her love of the Southwest and those vistas.
And her mother encouraged the girls to study art.
Yeah, she was one of seven, and there were, I believe she had two brothers and four sisters, right? Is my math correct? Anyway, and her mother was an educated woman and believed that her daughter should know about art, know about music, and Georgia was particularly gifted, but all of the O'Keeffe girls actually had an aptitude for art.
In 1916, she was an art teacher. And she goes to Texas and is teaching art, but she doesn't really have a degree. So she keeps going back to New York City to take art courses at Columbia.
Right. Yeah, she had a very interesting sort of young adulthood. I think now we call it a failure to launch. But she began and she went to the Art Institute of Chicago when she was 18. She was there for a year. She went home to, her family had moved to Williamsburg, Virginia, and she went home for the summer and she contracted typhoid and survived it. And she did not go back to Chicago. She then went to the Art Students League in New York, and it was one of those things where she was putting together a year here, a year there. And because she was never able to actually get that art teaching degree, she took any job that was offered to her. She wound up in Amarillo, Texas. She wound up in Canyon, Texas, you know, these sort of places in the far, far west that didn't require her to have graduated.
And she has a great friend named Pulitzer.
Right, right.
Who says to a man named Alfred Stieglitz, I have a friend, you should see her charcoal drawings.
Yes, yes. Anita Pulitzer was her good friend, her good girlfriend from the Art Institute, from the Art Students League in New York. And when Georgia moved out to Texas, they kept in touch. And even though O'Keeffe rather famously said, words and I are not friends, she and Anita wrote back and forth madly. And at that point in time, Alfred Stieglitz was sort of the Spielberg of the art world. I mean, he was it in New York. And if you were a young artist, it was very important that you got your work beneath the nose of Alfred Stieglitz and that he saw it. And one day, Georgia had sent Anita a roll of charcoal drawings that she had done, and she sort of very coyly said to Anita Pulitzer, I don't care if anybody likes these. The only person I would care about would be Alfred Stieglitz. And Anita took the drawings to Stieglitz, at which point he said, very famously, at last, a woman on paper.
Ah. And he was at that famous three-number place, 951?
I believe it was 291.
291
was the address on Fifth Avenue, yes.
And that was where everybody knew Stieglitz lived.
Right.
Stieglitz himself had married a wealthy woman.
Yes.
And it was her income that supported them.
Correct. He came from some money, and he had had a small trust settled on him by his father. But it was with the caveat that Emmy, his wife, was going to pay for their apartment and pay for their living, and then he could use his trust to work on his photography, and he published Camera Work, which was a little magazine, and have his gallery. So the money that he had was actually just to promote his art.
And our interesting friend, Georgia O'Keeffe, She wore always black. She had her hair pulled back, and she was not afraid of growing old or wrinkles or never marrying.
Right. All that's a lot of things there that she was not afraid of. Yeah, I think the thing that's interesting about her is that in the 20s, when you think of the 20s in New York, you think of flappers and you think of girls who bobbed their hair and wore short skirts and did the Charleston. And that was the era when O'Keeffe was in New York. And she did. She wore very conservative clothes. She always wore her hair long. She wore it pulled back off her face. She never wore any makeup. There's a funny story when in 1936, she was asked to paint a mural in the exercise salon at the Elizabeth Arden studio in New York. And Elizabeth Arden became her friend, and she said, "Oh, come on, Georgia, let me just do a makeover, just for fun. Let's see what you would look like with makeup." And Georgia permitted it, and the minute it was over, she scrubbed it all off her face, and she said, "You know, I just don't feel like myself with all this stuff on my face." So, yeah, she pretty much knew her style and knew how she felt comfortable from the get-go, from the very beginning.
She may have said she did not have a way with words, but she sure had a way with letters. She would write to Stieglitz. He would answer her back in the next mail. She would write back to him. And where are those letters collected now?